when I was matriculating at the Art Institute of Chicago, the dean of the school had a suspicion that I was not going to win a traveling fellowship. So he engineered it that I would receive a summer scholarship to Skowhegan here in Maine. As it turned out, I did win a traveling fellowship and spent a year in Europe. But on my way to Europe, I had a summer in Skowhegan, and that's what brought me to Maine. And it was because of a visit to Skowhegan that I met the gentleman who invited myself and my friend to come and see his island, which was Vinalhaven. And it was on that first day that I saw the Star of Hope, and within 10 days, Elliot Elisoffen, former Life magazine photographer, bought the building for me.
Yeah, that was quite a gesture on his part.
Elisoffen was starstruck, and he did like to rub elbows with people who had made names for themselves, and I think that was my case in point. As I say, my life is full of coincidences, and it's just an interesting coincidence that the man who bought this building for me, who brought me to Vinalhaven, was a staff photographer for Life magazine. Well, if there was one important influence in my life as far as art went, it was Life magazine, because for the first time there were good reproductions of American paintings as no other magazine, and it played it was a great influence in my life. Over the years, the Odd Fellows called their building here several different names, and when I riffled through some old stationery upstairs in the attic or in one of the closets, I found that at one time they had called it the Star of Hope, and since I've stars have always been one of my favorite motifs, why that was the one I chose. This is also Casa de Moore. I mean, you know, it's not only the Star of Hope, it's Casa de Moore. And as far as I'm concerned, love is still the most important thing. It all comes from a little painting which is now in the Portland Museum of Art. There were four stars, two stacked on two, with the word, just the regular word love down at the bottom. And that gave me the idea that the letters could be stacked as the stars were stacked. And just at that time, the Museum of Modern Art commissioned me to do a Christmas card for the museum. And that I submitted three designs or three color variations, And of course, they chose the one that became best known, the red, blue, and green, and that became the most popular Christmas card the museum had ever issued. The loves being red, blue, and green came about because of a Phillips 66 sign, which I used to see every day of my life when my mother would drive in to pick up my father on his 38th Street office. We would pass this huge Phillips 66 sign that was up in the sky. And in those days, Phillips 66 gasoline stations were all red and green. The attendants' uniforms were red and green, the oil cans were red and green, the gas pumps were red and green. And it was the red and green of that Phillips 66 sign against the blue sky that accounts for my favorite colors. It is, of course, my goal that love should cover the world, and that it should individually, it is growing, and we're laying plans to make a 24-foot love. And it's like Mount Everest. We all know what the highest mountain in the world is, and the larger love gets, the more attention it will receive. And of course, I haven't restricted myself to the English language. Ahava is the Hebrew word for love, and now I've involved with the Chinese word for love, which by coincidence happens to be I, and I, of course, is my first initial. Love wins out in the end, you see, and as far as I'm concerned, that's as it should be. That was just a simple, practical decision. My name was Robert Clark. All one has to do is look in any telephone book, and there are too many Clarks. And I simply wanted to steer away from that kind of being swamped in a sea of names. Know that somehow or another, of course, there are several artists named Smith, and the Smiths didn't seem to feel that they had to change their name. But there's a difference between Clark and Smith.
Are there misconceptions about you? I mean, are there things you'd like to clear up, things you'd like people to know that maybe they don't know?
Well, I think, as far as I'm concerned, probably my major regret is that due to love and what happened in the 60s, I'm only identified as a pop artist. And of course, I certainly didn't start out life as a pop artist. I started out making art when I was in the, before the first grade. The mill across the street from my grandmother's house in Mooresville, which of course was also John Dillinger's school. And in a department store in Indianapolis, this was my first painting sold for $10. And on eBay, I recently picked it up for $6,000. The first grade, that school where John Dillinger used to go to, turned out to be very important in my life because at the end of my first year, I would do drawings at home and bring them in and present them to my teacher. Well, it was that same teacher who, at the end of that first year in Mooresville, Indiana, asked if she might keep a couple of my drawings because she felt that one day I was going to be a famous artist. So I had no choice. It was inevitable. I had to become a famous artist. And 40 years later, I go back to this little town, and she's no longer teaching, but she's alive, and I have a coffee in her house. Never saw her in between. And she jumps up and goes in the bedroom and brings out my two drawings, and what she wants is that I sign them with my new name. She didn't want Robert Clark, she wanted Robert Indiana, as you say. The most important person in my life who greatly influenced me, of course, was Ellsworth Kelly. And our meeting was just pure chance. I'd been working for 3 years in an art store on 57th Street, and I had gotten up to the position of being able to arrange the windows. And I put postcards on display. And one day someone came in and asked for Matisse's Still Life with Oysters, and that person happened to be Ellsworth Kelly. I was desperately in the need of a new studio, and he just happened to know someone down on Coenties Slip who had some empty buildings available, and steered me to my first loft on Coenties Slip, was $30 a month. And that was the beginning of my most productive period, was on Coenties Slip. And so for several years we were neighbors on Coenties Slip, and then his old painter friend from France, Jack Youngerman, moved to the Slip with his wife, who was the French actress Delphine Sarigue. Then Agnes Martin showed up, and then James Rosenquist was another customer of mine at the art store, and he came and brought his friend Charles Hinman. And pretty soon we had a colony. Very private little enclave, all within three blocks of each other. Unfortunately, they began tearing those old buildings down, and we all had to clear out. Around 65, we were gone. For the early part of my life, I was simply a figurative painter. It was only when I met Ellsworth Kelly that I stopped being an American realist and became what I am now. I was stuck with the dilemma of being too much influenced by Ellsworth. I had to make some kind of a radical departure, and that was the addition of the word. And then shortly thereafter, Ellsworth never spoke to me again, you see. He didn't like paintings that had words, and I'm afraid many, many people in the art world didn't like paintings that had words. I've always considered myself the least pop of the pop artists, but given my place in time and what happened in the art world, I can't escape that designation. None of us really liked that term at the beginning. Other terms were used: new realists, vulgarians, all kinds of things, and then Lawrence Alloway's pop stuck, and then we were stuck. I consider my work primarily autobiographical. Almost everything I've done has some relationship to something in my life. I am painting and writing my own history. Involvement with numbers started with my mother and her insistence on moving from house to house in Indiana. Before I was 17 years old, I had lived in 21 different houses. And for my mother and father, their only amusement was really the automobile. And so we'd jump in the car and go driving around and check out all of those houses that we had lived in, and of course there was a number one, and there was a number two, and there was a number three. Know that it was in and around Indianapolis that I lived in those 21 different houses before I was 17 years old. My mother simply always had the feeling that the next house was going to be better than the last house, and as it turned out, it was just the opposite. As we moved on through the Depression, the houses got tackier and tackier. Of course, in Mooresville, it was my father was... Oh, we have a friend. Bring that guy. Bring that guy over, Bo. He wants to be in the film. Oh, he's my old buddy. Yes. Get in back of me. Hey, what are you doing, kid?
He's a people bird.
Oh, he is a people bird. Are you going to say something for us? Hey, what's wrong with you? Oh, he's a nice guy. Dale, you have to let it go. Well, I think we should talk about the dogs in my life,
too. Absolutely.
Suzu is the latest dog in my life. She happens to belong to one of my most valuable helpers, and she's a very new addition and probably one of the happiest I've ever had. She's a sweetheart of a dog, very, very affectionate. Yes, we got a good close-up of Suzu?
Yes, we do.
Oh, Suzu, you're going to be famous.
Yes,
Dale's going to make you famous.
He is.
Her predecessor happened to be a pit bull.
Didn't you have a Great Dane at one time?
Oh, yes. The most impressive dog of all, and that was Casso. He was so named so that when we took him for a walk, we could say Picasso. And out of deference to one of my favorite painters, of course. And he lived here on Vinyl Haven and managed to break my leg, pulled me down a snowbank. So my experience, I've had better luck with cats, let's put it that way. I was born in 28, so 27 is there because it's my fantasy that I might have been conceived in the backseat of a Model T Ford. And obviously, mother and father are dressed for conception, you see. Remember, Indiana's a pretty prim and proper state, so that's probably how they were dressed. Well, given the portrait of my mother and father, which was done in the middle of all of this 1960 business, that's about as realistic and as figurative as you can get. They're taken from actual family snapshots of my mother and father, slightly altered to make for a more arresting situation. And I really meant to continue that. The only trouble was those two paintings took me 4 years to finish, and it was almost too much a labor of love. And whereas I had meant to continue mother and father, they stand finished as they are. No, I wanted to do four seasons. As it stands, mother and father are standing in a very wintry road by their Model T in Indiana, and the thought was to do autumn with leaves on the trees and summer with green leaves, and then of course as the seasons got warmer, mother and father would begin to shed more clothing, whereas at this point she stands with one breast exposed, and my father has no trousers on. As spring and summer approached, there'd be less and less until I ended up with a nude mother and father. Some of my most important years, just personally and for my art, was the fact that I transferred from a country school. I was living with my mother. My mother and father had been separated. The country schools had no art, and I felt very, very deprived. Then my father, who was still working in Indianapolis at Phillips 66, invited me to join him and his new wife, my stepmother. And it just so happened that my stepmother's father was a janitor at Arsenal Tech, one of the largest high schools in Indianapolis. It's a 75-acre campus. It had been an old Civil War arsenal. All the original buildings were still there. The real grabber was there. The art department had a faculty of 12 teachers, not zero teachers, but 12 teachers. And I worked my schedule out so that in my senior year, out of an academic day of 8 hours, I had 6 hours devoted just to art. And that probably couldn't have happened in many other places. And that's when I became very involved with journalism. I was the photographic editor of the school yearbook, and then got a job at the Indianapolis Star. I worked at the Indianapolis Star for 3 years. So I became very close to journalism and writing and most importantly, type. Because in those days, things were still printed with type, you know. And my letters, of course, the three-dimensional letters are really just big pieces of type. The GI Bill, this was 1945-46, was about to expire, and so I had the premonition that that was a good time to enlist in the Army instead, and I got a 5 years of free schooling via the GI Bill. I spent a year in Alaska, did a little bit of artwork, but more journalism. I edited the camp newspaper called the Sourdough Sentinel, and I worked it up into the largest military newspaper in Alaska, and in the process gave myself a nervous breakdown, and so I was sent out to the Aleutians to recover. And of course, I fly out to the Aleutians, landed in a downpour, cold, nasty Aleutian weather, and I was handed a fishing pole and told that I had to catch my own dinner, you see. Well, that was not exactly recuperation. So how I really recovered was that my mother was dying of cancer in Indiana, and I went home on an emergency leave, and that ended my career in Alaska. She held on for much longer than she should have. I couldn't even recognize her when I saw her. And she struggled to, as I came in, to ask if I had something to eat. And then in 5 minutes, she was dead. That spurred me to work with the subject of Eat, Die. And of course, Eat, Die is a diptych. The two paintings should belong together. But in the course of time, they got separated. Its biggest realization, of course, came in 1964 at the New York World's Fair, with a large electric Eat sign that, unfortunately, I never have seen lit because the fair officials had to turn it off because people were forming in front of a theater to want to get something to eat, and there was nothing to eat. My mother died. I was still in the service. I had to go to Dayton, Ohio to be demilitarized, or whatever there's a name for it. And in the meantime, my stepfather also died. So I no longer had a home. It was Columbus, Indiana by that time. And I immediately enrolled at the Art Institute of Chicago, and that ended my experience with the state of Indiana. In my sculpture, I prefer the what probably were mainly beams, because they relate in form to the ancient herms which the Greeks and the Romans used, and most all of my wood pieces are herms, which Hermes was the messenger of the gods, and as a painter and as a sign painter, I feel that I'm delivering messages myself. All in all, I spent 12 years working on this opera, doing the sets and costumes. The first production happened to be in Minneapolis. The Mother of Us All is filled with characters from American history, from Susan B. Anthony through John Adams to Daniel Webster, a real circus of Americana. The lead romantic heroine in The Mother of Us All just happened to be named Indiana Elliott, so I couldn't resist that possibility. Stein is her text, and her messages are filled with preoccupations with names and name changes, and right up my alley. Through various connections, mainly because of one of my largest collectors, who was a close friend of the man who ran the Santa Fe Opera, It was brought to Santa Fe. Mr. Crosby, the owner of the opera, decided that that would be a fitting work to celebrate the bicentennial 1976. And I spent a whole summer in Santa Fe. The opera house is absolutely beautiful, and everything they did there was very, very professional. Well, it turned out that the opera was a great success. It began with a fireworks display over the mesa in the background of the opera house, and it was a real Americana pageantry, and beautiful performance. It got great reviews. I was on the cover of Art News, the one of my sets that I did. The sets and costumes were all made out of felt, and I think there was some trepidation about that at the beginning, but if you've ever been in Santa Fe at night, it gets rather chilly, so those opera singers didn't really mind wearing felt costumes at all. The opera was only given a few performances, and after the opera was given, the owner, who much preferred more classical kind of works, moved all of my sets out onto the mesa in back of the opera house and set fire to them, and that was the end of the Mother of Us All. The other portraits really started on Quentin's slip, and they started when my career really started. In other words, I felt myself a worthwhile subject for something by that. By 1960, things were happening for me. On Coenties Slip, there was a square block called Jeanette Park, immediately in front of my studio, and it had several ginkgo trees, and the ginkgo, the history of the ginkgo, I found rather fascinating. I took the leaf form and doubled it, and that's the subject of some early paintings, and more recently they've been incorporated into my Chinese Love series. Finding the Star of Hope simply changed my life. Mm-hmm. I had a 12-year lease on the Bowery, and after 14 years had passed, remember, this is a block down the street from Louise Nevelson's studio. Across the street was Lichtenstein's studio. There were a number of artists living on the Bowery, and at that time the Bowery was still very much the Bowery. It was not gentrified in any way. I had a 12-year lease. I overextended my lease. The landlord politely suggested that I should remove myself from my five-floor studio. And that was quite a burden because I did own the Star of Hope. I had only come here in the autumn. I didn't want to be associated as a summer person. And of course, September and October are the two nicest months on the island. and my crew, mainly lobstermen here on the island, moved me. It took two vans, 12 trips, to bring all my possessions from that five-story building to what essentially, at that time, I had only two floors in this building. And it was quite a hassle. And that's when they rented that little grocery store, which turned out to be on the back lot of Marsden Hartley's house when he lived here in 1938. And it was just that coincidence that propelled my interest in Marsden Hartley. I'd never been particularly interested in him before. And that was the beginning of the Hartley Elegies, and I probably spent about 6 years working on the Hartley Elegies, all in homage to Marsden Hartley, who probably every day that he went to the post office, he walked right across the front of my building. Those, the rectangle is there, the black and white elegy. I did tondos and I did diamonds. There were three different shapes. I'm very fond of those shapes. The tondos are the only elegies that bear no words. Only the Iron Cross, and of course it's that Iron Cross which has got me into trouble with the art world. One of my favorite American paintings is Demas Figure 5, and of course that there's a long line of coincidences in back of that, in that the poet William Carlos Williams was on his way to visit Marsden Hartley, and it was a miserable night, it was pouring down rain, and all of a sudden a fire engine goes screeching by, and on the front of it is the number 5, and that became the subject of Demas' Golden 5 painting. And I expanded it into several canvases, and it's probably what I consider one of my very best works. Well, know that I hesitated for a long time to work with the image of Marilyn Monroe. I hesitated to work with Marilyn because Andy had so completely covered that subject. But finally, I just decided enough time had passed that I could venture into that particular territory, and I had the exhibit that I missed in France because of 9/11 was a Marilyn Monroe show, and all of my Marilyn paintings went to France except one, and this was another bit of strange luck. I left a window open on the third floor. The rain came all the way down the building through that little crack there in the ceiling and put a stain on this canvas. Well, it is raw linen, and to redo this painting completely was just an impossible thought. I left the stain, and of course, on second thought, the stain belongs on that canvas. She is gradually becoming that other love goddess called Monica. The painting is the celebration of a love goddess. And of course, Marilyn was a love goddess to one president named Kennedy, and Monica was a love goddess to another president named Clinton, you see. There was a play by Edward Albee, which got great attention at the time. This is early in the 60s. Albee's work also was autobiographical. And I went to see The American Dream and was obviously struck by it. And although that phrase, of course, is part and parcel of American lore. I mean, people have been talking about the American Dream long before Edward Albee. And that painting was probably the most important that I ever did, because it was hung in a two-man show in a less than conspicuous gallery in New York. And absolutely nothing happened for either of us, nothing sold. But when the show came down, Alfred Barr, the director and the founder of the Museum of Modern Art, happened to saunter in and saw it and acquired it for the Museum of Modern Art. And that more or less started my whole career with kind of a bang. I continued that over the years. The second Dream was purchased by the president of the Board of Trustees of the Museum of Modern Art. The third Dream was my first painting acquired by a museum in Europe. It went to Eindhoven, Holland. The fourth Dream went into the Hirshhorn Museum in Washington, D.C. The fifth Dream went into the museum in Toronto, and that one is related to the Demuth Five. Then the sixth Dream didn't immediately have such spectacular success, but of course the sixth Dream is about my father, because he was he grew up in a family of six, born in June, and worked for Phillips 66. And when he left my mother, he went to California on Highway 66, so it very much became associated with him. There are several sixth Dream paintings, and they have gone to various and different places. The seventh Dream had a much more spectacular career, and that was done. I was soon to have my largest retrospective ever in the Museum of Contemporary Art in Nice, in France. And the seventh Dream, because it was Nice and it would be hanging in that particular museum, I decided to celebrate the American women who went to France and flowered, primarily Josephine Baker, the black entertainer, and Princess Grace, of course, who was Prince Rainier's wife, and then Isadora Duncan. And they all knew Nice very well, and that Dream celebrated those ladies. The eighth Dream, because the eight is related to the month of August, my mother was born in August. The eighth Dream is an homage to my mother. That happens to be here in the house. And then the ninth Dream, which will be my last Dream, was the principal painting in my first gallery show in New York in years and years at the Kasman Gallery. And that went into the hands of a private collector. That's the end of the American Dream. After 9/11, I painted the flags on the front of the building and rename Zeus Zero to commemorate what happened. I watched the destruction of the World Trade Center, and it kept me from attending an exhibit of mine in France. I came back to Vinyl Haven and started the piece paintings. Now, actually, what I came back and painted after 9/11 was Afghanistan. Was not a peace painting. It was, let's revenge ourselves for 9/11. The Afghanistan painting was presented to the UN in New York, and they expressed interest in showing it until they saw the actual image, and then the people at the UN decided maybe that was not a good idea for the UN. A painting which very much came out of my Confederacy series, my protest against what was happening in the South in the 60s. The peace paintings have come about because of Mr. Bush's war in Iraq, not 9/11. I switched from a hawk to a dove. I'm glad I repaired that situation. Certain artists feel compelled to deal with, you know, important issues, whereas other artists are painting flowers and nudes, and depends upon the artist's temperament, and I'm simply a person who I'm enormously interested in history and current events, and of course with my peace paintings, I know they will have no effect whatsoever, but it's a wishful thought that they might possibly influence world developments. Obviously they're failing completely. I mean, you know, art can have a limited effect. Obviously, not too many people go to museums. More people are going to ball games and other things. We have lost our, I think we've lost our influence. Thank you. probably more of my work is involved with the upbeat and the positive rather than the negative, but I can't forget the negative aspect. It's like eat and die. Unfortunately, eat is accompanied by die, and we're stuck with that problem whether we like it or not. Immortality is the only chance, you see.